Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2016. Can I remind all those present to ensure that all electronic devices are switched off? Our first item is to take evidence on school spending and the educational attainment gap. Now, over the past year or so, we have taken a considerable amount of evidence on these overlapping topics. But in doing so, we obviously understand that much more information is now in the public domain, and we hope that this will help to stimulate an open and transparent discussion. Now, our last two reports on the Scottish Government's draft budgets have both focused on school spending, and we've been told about some of the challenges facing local authorities and schools. We've also been told that there is not always a clear link between spending on education and the outcomes that this delivers. Now, one outcome I trust that all those with an interest in education share is that the attainment gap between the least and the most disadvantaged pupils should be narrowed significantly. Now, I hope this morning's discussion will help us to understand how we can make best progress on that shared aim. And with that in mind, can I welcome to committee Councillor Stephanie Primrose, COSLA Robert Nicol, COSLA Councillor Paul Godzik, the City of Edinburgh Council, Councillor Gary Robinson, Shetland Islands Council, Councillor Malcolm Cunning from Glasgow City Council, and Ian Robertson, also Glasgow City Council. Can I welcome all of you to the committee this morning, and thank you for agreeing to come along and discuss this important subject with us. I'm going to go straight to questions from members, and I believe, Gordon, you've got the first question.
Yeah, okay, thanks very much, Convener. There's no doubt there's been pressure on local authority budgets over recent years. However, in terms of educational attainment, there has been a 6.3% point increase in the percentage of pupils achieving 5-plus awards at SQA Level 6 since 2010-11, and 4 percentage points increases in young people entering positive destinations upon leaving school, hitting 93%. So how do we balance the situation where, you know, ultimately there has been pressure on the education budget, but we're still achieving good educational outcomes?
1 point there, I'll maybe come back to that. You're absolutely correct about the 93% of positive destinations. I would like to raise 1 point, and there are a number of points I would probably want to go back to as well, is that we do have positive destinations, but I think we need to actually break that down a wee bit further. And I think we actually need to look at sustainable destinations. I think from my own authority, we've got 97% going into sustainable positive destinations. I would like to see in 6 months' time whether we're still there. So that's 1 point I would like to make. I don't know if anybody else wants to come in.
Can I just make a point about positive destinations? Yeah. I think it's a good point, and it's something that we are looking to improve constantly. Edinburgh obviously had a specific situation. Edinburgh was bottom of the league table, just a few years ago. We put in specific resources round about the Edinburgh Guarantee, and we got a commitment right across the city to buy into that, and we're now thankfully at the Scottish average. So there does need to be a sustained focus on it, and I think Edinburgh Guarantee and things like that are helping improve that figure.
Thanks, Convener. I would echo Stephanie's point there. Shetland in recent times has topped the table for positive destinations, and part of that has been due to the high level of well-paid employment that's been in the islands lately, particularly through the construction phase of the Shetland gas plant. But in seeing those positive destinations, we also saw a drop in people going to higher and further education. Now, my belief is that a number of people took a gap year and went to make themselves some money rather than get themselves into student loan debt. But we've yet to see if that actually comes through in the next set of figures. But there certainly isn't the amount of available work that was 2 or 3 years ago. So, like Stephanie, I think it's one to watch. I'm not sure if it can be sustained.
Sorry, Malcolm.
Clearly the situation in Glasgow is one where we have knocked around the bottom of the table for a number of years, but certainly in recent years we have both improved Glasgow year on year, but also closed the gap in terms of comparison with other local authorities. And I think that's positive outcome for both Glasgow and more particularly for Glasgow students. We still have numbers, I think it's 90% roughly positive destination, and most of the figures are reasonably comparable. The one where we stand out slightly is there are still a higher proportion of school students in Glasgow going straight from school into unemployment, and that would be one where I think the Scottish average is around 5% and we're 7.5 or something. It's roughly that sort of area, and that would be a particular concern. But what we've achieved has really been achieved by changes in working practice by many of the teachers, taking good examples from some of the schools that have very successfully turned round their achievements, both in terms of exam success and in terms of outcomes, and taking those achievements out across the entire school provision within the city.
In a Glasgow context, I arrived in Glasgow in 2008, and it's not just because I arrived, but since 2008, because of the collective leadership, both political and officer-led, that's been a step change in terms of how Glasgow's progressed since then. You know, I'm a very practical person, so what I saw when I first arrived in Glasgow was quite a patchwork in terms of the quality of teaching that was going on. And therefore, one of the first leadership challenges was mediocrity will not be tolerated. In other words, you've got to actually be the best you can be. So that was a big drive in terms of making sure that. And the other critical thing, quite frankly, is just the quality of leadership in our schools. And again, that was quite mixed. I would say we've got some outstanding head teachers now. So those two things alone, the quality of leadership and the quality of teaching that goes on in a classroom, are the most profound things that will make a difference.
I mean, I agree with you. Quality of leadership is important, because I know in the Western Hills Education Centre, they, in my constituency, they turned around their exam results, and that was about attitude and quality of leadership in there, and it changed it around. But, you know, in terms of seeing an increase in what pupils are achieving and the positive destinations, I mean, what impact has the investment in, say, school estate had? You know, we've had over 600 schools rebuilt over the last 8 years, and the number of schools in a bad condition have dropped from 134 in 2008 to 11 in 2015. I mean, what impact has that had? Or is it purely about leadership that's pushed this achievements that we're seeing?
Help with that, and then colleagues can jump in. Yeah. I mean, on the specific point of the school estate, I think it's actually quite hard to say if you refurbish or rebuild X number of schools, then that gives you X return in terms of attainment. I don't think the evidence is there. Clearly, if you improve the educational environment, then that is helpful towards what you're actually trying to achieve in terms of outcomes for children. But I wouldn't say, and I'm sure colleagues here would say, it's not the clinching factor. And here, there's a range of things, including quality of teaching practice within the school, leadership within the school, the performance system that authorities and Education Scotland can bring. So there are a range of sort of levers in there that are probably stronger than simply renovating the school estate. I mean, your first question was about the link between pounds spent and attainment, and clearly there is, at some level, there is a link there, but it is not in a sort of direct thing. If you spend a number, that gives you a better return in terms of, it's more, and there is evidence the OECD pick up on that, you know, it's what you spend your money on rather than the quantity and the quantity overall, and it's about how councils have that flexibility to be able to really target resources at those areas that they feel are necessary to get the best return in terms of local outcomes.
In terms of the school estate, I mean, I would say it's one of many ingredients. You know, to be perfectly honest, you know, I think, as Robert said, it's not the main ingredient. I would say that, you know, teachers and leadership are the main ingredients in terms of raising attainment. But you know, if you look at the kind of facilities that we are delivering now, the learning environment and the opportunities that brings for our pupils to learn in different and innovative ways, then clearly, you know, improving the school estate is part of, you know, a big picture.
Can I just make a point about the school estate as well? You're talking about attainment. But we have a number of schools we were looking at achievement. It's not necessarily about getting your yes. S5 hires. I was in one of our own state-of-the-art special needs schools, and it's things about the hydrotherapy pools. I mean, they make a huge difference to, you know, young people who have, you know, severe learning difficulties and severe physical disabilities. So they may not come out with 5 hires, but they come out with a better feeling of welfare. Just one point I would like to make, and Robert has touched on it, that a lot, I think, personally, that our teaching profession has changed. You know, I think that now we have a far more focused view on our actual pupils. When I look at the curriculum for excellence, you know, the curriculum for excellence is about individuals. And I think our staff and our head teachers, they know our individuals. And I think that through the curriculum for excellence, that these individuals have been targeted, they've been encouraged, and they're going into what they want to go into. So that, you know, we are moving from having success only in English maths, you know, as being seen as what people want. It's actually embracing the wider context, so that we do have people in hospitality. We're opening a school that has a barista in it, you know, who's, you know, going to do mixology. I'm not quite sure what that is. But, you know, we're catering for individuals, and I think that's a huge leap. You know, certainly, you know, I said a while ago, but when I was at school, that wasn't the case. You sat down, you copied from the board. And now we've got teachers who are really looking at how individuals learn, looking at learning styles, looking at how lessons are delivered. And I think that's key as well to raising attainment.
John.
Morning. Over the past couple of months, we've seen a sort of fierce reaction to the local government settlement, and especially the impact that that could very likely have on education. And, you know, and perhaps much of that protest has came from Labour-controlled authorities. In that respect, in COSLA's own submission, even taken on board that the process of setting the budget is still to be finalised. In your report, you talk about what a cash cut will mean, real pain for education. The most vulnerable could be hardest hit. There will be a human cost to the government's decision. Could you perhaps tell me what kind of specific examples of how the change in total resource for councils might impact on school services?
Could kick off from one of the Labour-controlled councils, where, I mean, clearly we haven't settled our budget entirely and won't settle our budget until March the 10th. But over a two-year period, we're looking at savings of £133 million out of Glasgow City Council's entire budget. That is bound to have an effect on education, even though clearly we've got a commitment, A, to stick to the guidelines in terms of teacher numbers, and a political commitment to maintaining services, particularly as far as possible within social work and education. But in the budgeting process, what we have to look at are other costs within education, whether that's specific music and art provision. We're having to look at staff support in terms of additional support for learning in some of the schools. As I say, decisions have not been made in that, but what you may well find is that there are fewer support staff within the schools, and therefore teachers are standing at the photocopier rather than standing in the classroom. There is no way that local authorities can save sums like £133 million over the space of 2 years, and there is not some level of impact in terms of the educational provision. Now, clearly there's a commitment to try and make sure that that impacts as little as possible on the learning experience of individual students in our schools, whether that's primary, secondary or in nursery, but it is going to be very, very difficult to achieve.
Thanks, Convenor. I'm an independent councillor leading an independent council, but I think we've experienced exactly the same thing. We've said many of the same things that the Labour councils have said. It is going to be extremely difficult. I'm a bit annoyed at having recently heard ministers talking about a 1% cut to local government. I'm sorry, I don't know that council, I don't recognise it, and if I could put some figures on the table for my own council, we've seen the biggest percentage cut in local government expenditure this year, 5.1% cash. Our budget is just over £100 million. Our grant in the current financial year was £87 million. Our grant in the next financial year is going to be £82 million. And we're getting about a £1 million share of health and social care integration money. So you do the maths. I can't get that anywhere near to 1% that's been quoted. It's far more significant than that. My council has been at pains to protect education spending up until now, but I doubt very much that we can continue that into the future. Something has got to give. It's becoming extremely difficult to maintain the level of education expenditure when we're maintaining teacher numbers, when it's extremely difficult to close schools or amalgamate schools. I think local government is being given a very difficult proposition here, and it's difficult to see if there are future cuts, how those can be dealt with.
I mean, I'd largely agree with the last two contributions. We set a budget very early this year. It's an SNP and Labour coalition, but we set it with great difficulty. And you know, over the budget framework 16 to 20, we expect to take £140 million out of the local government budget in Edinburgh. For 16-17, we're looking at £11 million worth of savings over the communities and families. Directorate. Now that obviously covers education, but it also covers children's social works and CLD. And you know, just you know, go back to the contributions that your previous colleagues made. Yes, we are doing so. You know, every turn trying to protect direct education spending. And you know, we have given a commitment in terms of the devolved school management budget, which goes directly to head teachers. But round the edges, there is a real impact. And that may be music tuition, that may be pupil support. And you know, these are things that we are having to look at just because of the scale of the budget reductions.
I think you were my concerns, and of course I agree with my colleagues around the table, is that we will have to, you know, look at what one may consider peripheral. So we are talking about music, we are talking about school transport. You know, that, as you are aware, has a statutory element to it. But one of the things that really concerns me, and I will not apologise for actually raising this again, is that our most vulnerable children, who really require services through, you know, social work, through educational psychologists, through family workers, caseworkers and things like that, these will be the services that we actually have to look at, because we're actually having to protect our core. And I think, you know, we really need to take that into consideration, that, you know, if we want our young children to achieve, if we want our children to achieve what they want to, you achieve what they can, then they need to be safe, they need to be healthy, and they need to be actually emotionally able to cope with education. And that's where my big concern is, that service may be the one that is taking a hit.
I think the focus is on the 17 budget setting difficulties that local authorities are having at the moment. We can't ignore the compound effect over the last 8 years. Because if I quote Glasgow figures, they'll be broadly similar with other local authorities. Since 2008, the Education Service has had to reduce its budget by £70 million, so it's about 13%. So if you use that well-worn phrase, all the low-hanging fruit's already gone, you're now actually cutting into to core services. And having been in this game for 30-odd years, my concern now is about some of the really good work we've done around about early intervention right across Scotland, and that's where we're going to make the generational change, the generational impact. Those are the services that are going to be vulnerable. I think if I tie it into teacher numbers, for example, in terms of how we're funded, because there's also that context in terms of what nationally has been supported, and then what local decisions are made around about what they want to do in terms of priority. So Glasgow's got a very large nurture programme, and within your papers you've got all the context in terms of how effective nurture programme. That's early intervention. Glasgow spends about £4 million a year on its nurture programme, with massive impact and improvement in terms of children's outcomes, but it's not part of the settlement. That's a local decision. They are now, so in terms of where we're sitting now, in terms of, but we'll be held to account for that as part of our teacher number. That's a local decision, but yeah, it's been held to account nationally for something that's not funded.
Sorry. Can I thank the witnesses for giving some specific and indeed some peripheral answers there? But with regards to the attainment gap, do you see the cutback in budget having an impact on that? Now, what I'm thinking in particular is that, you know, whilst we've got to keep up the teacher numbers, and but the teacher numbers need the support, do you think that the budget reduction is going to, you know, have an impact on the support that the teachers need?
Yes. You know, teachers, you know, they have a job to do. You know, if we cut back on things like classroom assistance, if we cut back on, you know, the support that we have in, then teachers are going to have to deal more and more with that type of thing. That you know, teachers are going to have to deal with all the emotional baggage that children have. They're not social workers, they're not counsellors. And I think, you know, as we cut back on those services, teachers are going to be under actually increasing strain to deal with some of the really complex issues. I mean, you know, some of the children that I've come across, you know, I didn't even have on my radar, you know, some of the complexities they come from, their backgrounds they come from, the poverty. And actually, if we can talk about poverty within our society, that's where we need to make changes as well.
If I can add something as well, I mean, certainly the reduction local government face won't make closing the attainment gap any easier. That goes without saying. I think when you look at, as we've said often enough, the sort of evidence of what does close gaps like that, it really comes in. You can't really say it's any one thing. It's clearly there's an element of what happens within schools, and that comes down to the leadership within the school. It comes to within the actions of individual teachers. But you can't isolate the school from wider services that councils deliver, delivered by the voluntary sector as well. All of that goes in to really tackling the attainment gap. And when you isolate elements like teacher numbers, when you look, as we've said often enough, when you look at the variation that we have seen in Scotland over the years, there is no evidence to suggest that the changes in teacher numbers actually makes a material difference in terms of attainment. So there is no one single solution to this, but when you're constrained in terms of overall funding, when your flexibility is reduced in terms of how you can redirect funding locally, that must have an impact on the things that you can do locally to tackle things like the attainment gap.
Unless you've got something radically different to say. No, I think, well, time's against us this morning. It's a big panel and six people saying the same thing, if you don't mind. It doesn't really get us anywhere, so I want to keep us moving on. You okay, John? Right, George.
Good morning. Sorry for sneeze or sniff all the way through. Man flu, at its worst. But I'd like to carry on from some of the questions that John was asking there. You know, we obviously live in an environment where obviously Scottish Government's had devastating cuts from Westminster Government, and we're not going to have that debate right here, right now. But, you know, we're in a situation where we're trying to deal with the future and with education as well. And as a former councillor myself, I'm a great believer in, even though we live in challenging times, even though I believe it's a difficult settlement, but it's a fair settlement the local government's got. It's always been that way in my experience as a local councillor in the past. You know, but where are the big ideas? Where are the solutions? You know, I believe in, there's no such thing as a problem, only solutions. I think it's mainly because my mother brought me up on a diet of John Lennon records. But apart from that, where are the solutions? Where are the big ideas? Where are the big ideas coming from local government to try and make this challenging situation better and try and find? All I've heard is about the difficulties that you've got with the budget. Where's the big ideas? I know they're out there, and I know local government's always kind of at the forefront when it comes to these innovative ideas.
I think in lots of local authorities there are lots of ideas. There are either ideas that have been developed within the local authority or ideas that have been developed across the teaching profession and the education establishment. I mean, in Glasgow, for example, the improvement challenge across the secondary estate. Ian has already described the nurturing programme because there's the absolute, I think, accepted idea that the earlier you can get in and start improving educational attainment, that is going to have an outcome in 13 years or 14 years down the line, because the gap for those who come from the most impoverished parts of our inner city areas, and Glasgow's got more of them than anyone else, the gap can be around a year in terms of educational attainment at the age of five. And we've got to do something around that area. And there's loads of work going on in education within local authorities, in my local authority and in other local authorities. that cannot be done are maintained without significant financial investment, freeing up time for teachers to be able to do some of that new imaginative and innovative work, and the pressure on teachers' time as a result of cuts, as we've already described in other support areas, is going to make that exceedingly more difficult.
I agree with you. I think challenge. Sorry, apologies.
Just to add to that, I think, you know, there are ideas out there. There are some fantastic practice going on in schools right across the city, right across the country. But, you know, to add to the point that's just been made, if you constrain the flexibility, you know, through increasing Scottish Government directions in terms of, you know, how we direct our resources, then that innovation, you know, those ideas are not going to come through to fruition.
I think we do have some very good things that show really good practices about sharing these practices. I want to just pick up two and mention a third. You know, I think we have two extremely well thought out and things that are working very well. That's our Developing the Young Workforce programme. You know, that is bringing together, you know, private sector, it's bringing together third sector, it's bringing together, you know, a huge amount of expertise, and that's having benefits for our young people, because that's experts actually helping our young people through business. And I think as well, and I do absolutely accept the fact that I think early years is absolutely critical, and I would actually like to take the fact just to identify the work of the early years collaborative. It doesn't matter that I both co-chair them, I think they are both very, very good examples of how we can think together and do something big.
Thanks. I think, as others have said, the ideas certainly are out there. My own council started work in the Shetland Learning Partnership before the ink was even dry on Sir Ian Wood's report. And that's been an excellent initiative that's been hailed by Skills Development Scotland as being one of the best that they've seen. And we have a process whereby we're actually bringing young folk on to get them involved in work and vocational education at an early stage when they're still in school. I think it's hugely helpful as well, because the pilot scheme that we started last year was focused on social care and engineering, and those are two areas that, as a council and local employers, there is real difficulty in recruiting, and those young folk are actually going to leave school with a vocational qualification as well as their academic qualification, so they're well suited to enter the labour market. As part of the programme as well, all of the young folk that are involved in it have got a summer placement scheme, so they're actually learning skills in a workplace that they can then take on to their career. So I think the ideas are very much out there, but I would echo what others have said. It's about giving local government the flexibility to bring these things forward.
I agree with you. I think challenge, as I said, brings opportunity, and some of the ideas that you might have thought 10 years ago were unthinkable are now actually on the table. We've mentioned early years. I think senior phase is a massive area for some quite radical reform. Some of it's already in train, some of it's yet to come. I do think that senior phase is a very expensive component part of education, and if you want to actually put the account in, it can be a very inefficient part of the curriculum when you're sitting down with your secondary head teachers and saying, if your raison d'etre is to optimise choice for young people, then you can't have schools as islands. And that's what that's how they've been working for years. They try to be all things to all people, and invariably I'm the person that gets complaints about why can't my daughter do three sciences at that school, because we can't offer it. But and I think it's a city context as much as anything else, is that there's far more radical models coming forward now in terms of looking at, for example, advanced higher hubs. So you'll actually be moving youngsters about the city at any point during the day so that you can actually get a decent cohort of youngsters actually doing the same subject. We'll be moving some of the advanced higher programmes and higher programmes, minority hires, into twilight activity. And actually there's some soft benefits from that as well, because these are young people who need to start thinking about how they're actually going to mature and move on to their next stage of their stage of learning. So they need to be far more self-sufficient and resilient in terms of all that movement. That's quite doable in a city context, because you're never more than a mile away from another local authority. I think we're going to be forced down the greater use of technology in terms of as part of the learning experience. I mean, it's been about since Open University, but if you take a very pragmatic view at the moment, if you cannot get a physics teacher for love nor money, why can't you have a virtual one? You know, so I think we're going to be pushed down using certain very practical challenges that we face at the moment. But I do think the senior phase in itself will give us probably some of the most radical reform we've seen in the education service in many a year.
Thank you. George?
Now we're talking because I'm loving the positivity from everybody there as well. And if we're talking about the flexibility, you know, can we not create the flexibility in local government? Because as a former councillor again, the holy grail was always joint services and working together, not reinventing the wheel, not restructuring local authorities, but more about working together more cleverly. even if I can't say it. If possibly that's the way forward for us all. You know, I know it should be a way. I know we've discussed this before and some of you have been here before, but surely there's a way we can use back-of-house services to work together or some other ways in education that we can actually find a way to create that flexibility that you all need to try and deliver the service that we all want.
I think you're absolutely right about having greater flexibility. And I think one of the things we have to do, and goes back to a point that was made already, is that, you know, we need to bring our colleges in. You know, we need to, if we can, you know, share our education with our colleges as well. I think one thing I would say about the shared services is that we're lean. We're very, very lean at the moment. I mean, a lot of the cuts that we've been taking is across councils, it's actually coming from the management structures. So I would be concerned about the workload on our managers there. I mean, I think from my own point of view, we've gone from 7 heads of service to 1. And I think if you had that across Pan Ayrshire, in my example, I think it would be a huge, huge job. And I don't know that we'd be any better off for it. Well, I think what we do at the moment is actually very good. Do we need to change that?
Surely it's not necessarily about, I mean, the point George is making is it's not about one manager running Pan Ayrshire services, but surely, you know, you could have, for example, a single payroll system, a single finance department across Ayrshire. Mm-hmm. Do you have that now?
I'm not a great expert on ICT at all. I need to go back. I don't think so, no.
Right.
But I think Councillor, and I will say, I maybe get asked Robert to come on this. From what I thought Councillor used different. Yeah. I mean,
clearly, there's an appetite within the councils to share services where we can be shared, and we've given examples before of Pan-Tayside authorities that are looking to share services around language learning. I think the point that we wanted to make around this is councils have been doing a variety of things around efficiencies for a great number of years, both in terms of within authorities integrating services, but also working with health boards and the like, and we're just really moving into the sort of the next phase of integrating services around health and social care. So the idea that there isn't integrated thinking both within councils and in across is just completely wrong. Then it comes down to, I think, the savings that can probably be delivered by likes of shared services. And we've not seen any convincing case made that the sorts of things that you're talking about could actually deliver the significant savings that you maybe would want, and certainly wouldn't be helpful in terms of meeting the challenges that we are currently facing. I think they're not, shared services are not a panacea, as we said before, to the challenges faced by local government. And it's interesting to note in the Scottish Government's responses, they haven't suggested anything like what you have brought up there either. I think if they thought there was a case to be made for that, they would have made that stronger in their response.
Well, I think we'll see what happens in the future. But I think many of these questions, Robert, I think are questions that now finally have to be faced. Nobody suggested that it was a panacea, but I think obviously all of these discussions now have to take place about how we operate and how we operate as efficiently as possible. I think it's a perfectly reasonable question to raise. Gordon, did you have a supplementary? You okay with that? Check.
Last commentary about shared services. In Ayrshire is particularly important when they've just split up a very successful tourism team across the three Ayrshires into three separate units. I wonder if I may ask, and I agree with the questions that George Adam put in terms of the can-do, and I'm not saying that a lot hasn't been done, but the can-do attitude of how we optimise the services like ICT, etc., across neighbouring councils. One of the things that we talked about in terms of delivering the best results that have been mentioned this morning is the leadership skills and how they're applied. And in considering that, I just wonder if, in looking at the Improvement Services Benchmarking Report, that there are individual variations in pupil, per pupil spend across the country. In fact, you've just alluded to that, in fact, how different it is. And the variation provides opportunities to explore how some services are designed and delivered, maybe shared, in ways that achieve greater efficiencies in expenditure. I wonder if you can share with us the reasons that for the variation between different local authorities and what action has been taken to address this. For example, where there are certain, you've talked about Glasgow's Nurture programme, the various successes, how are we sharing the outcomes, the beneficial outcomes in each, you know, where each council or a council delivers a programme which clearly is having some impact on attainment? How are we sharing that across Scotland and via the councils?
Used as through the professional body, Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, it has what they describe as a series of networks. So you'll have the early years network, you'll have the curriculum and teaching network, and that's an initial vehicle in order for local authorities to actually showcase and share some of the innovative and high-performing services that have been designed. I mean, I think we are still, as a society, a bit kale-yard. If we've got a good idea, we quite like to keep it to ourselves, you know, in case anybody, because it's all about in terms of how you compare in a league table. So if you share your good idea, somebody might catch up with you.
Doesn't that validate what we've just discussed? That if you have a good idea, you like to keep it in your own kale-yard?
Oh, absolutely. I think that's something that we are getting better at, but I think we need to be far more open. I think sometimes it's just in our human nature, isn't it? You know, we don't like to brag, you know, when we're doing something well or
well, I
good.
Think it goes beyond that. Mm. It's more to do with turf wars and personalities. So how do we encourage the sharing of the knowledge across Scotland?
I mean, can I just say, you know, to give credit where credit's due, the Scottish Government's attainment challenge will do just that. When you look at the range of, you know, innovative practice that has been brought forward, you know, right across, you know, my own city in Edinburgh, but right across Scotland, it will help and it will assist us, you know, looking at what works and hopefully promoting that right across the country. So, you know, I don't dismiss, you know, that it's a limited amount of investment, but it's investment that will help and will assist us, you know, share good practice.
Good. Thank you.
I just want to pick up on the variation in costs, because I think that's a very good question. But thinking about it in my own respect, I mean, my local authority still has the highest cost per pupil in the whole of Scotland. And there's very little we can do about that at the moment. Some of that comes from transport costs. Some of our children have to be brought to school by aircraft. Flown into the secondary school and put up in accommodation through the week. But another thing is the number of schools that we have. We have 31 schools, six of which are secondary schools. The Western Isles has a landmass twice that of Shetland and has, I think, 24 schools at the last count, three secondary schools. So there's your costs right there. So the pupil-to-teacher ratios have a significant impact on that. Number of schools have a significant impact on that.
Just that, I mean, obviously the Audit Scotland report in education in 2014, you know, gave an analysis round about both urban and rural authorities. I think that was very useful, because there are obviously, you know, distinct challenges in rural authorities that you know, we in Edinburgh, you know, don't have to meet. But in terms of attainment, I think, you know, when you compare cost per pupil to attainment, you know, we in Edinburgh are you know, round about the bottom. You know, in terms of league table, in terms of cost per pupil, but you know, but our outcomes are good. Our attainment is continually rising, and has been rising, you know, over the last last number of years.
Yeah, I just want to very briefly, Convenor, may come back to the issue of leadership skills. I mean, I know of one school in Ayr where the headmaster shows inordinate leadership skills, and that's reflected in the attainment of the pupils. I mean, how are we defining, I mean, how are we finding those that have the skills to lead the schools and develop the, as Ian rightly says, ICT capabilities, the sharing of knowledge, virtual classrooms? How do we find these people? Or how do we, because you can't train people to be leaders, in my view. So how do you find them? How do you find these people?
Just, it's on the last bit. I mean, I actually am a trained teacher, but from many, many, many years ago, and wasn't a teacher for very long. But I do think you can train and support some of the leadership skills, and I do think the training centres, whether that's at Glasgow, Edinburgh, Aberdeen or whatever, can contribute to that. But then above that is through the professional organisations, through the trade unions, etc., is sharing some of the experience and sharing some of the skills and ideas that come from individual teachers. I'm not going to name them, but I could name schools in Glasgow where clearly individual head teachers have made a very, very significant difference, turned schools around, and that has then been used as an exemplar to other senior staff in other schools, this happens across the board. But it's not simply local authorities. I do think the colleges, I still think of the old colleges of education, the centres of teacher training, etc., have got something to do with that, and we can build on individuals. What you're never going to do is absolutely replicate time after time that outstanding individual who will always exist in every local authority. From time to time, someone will come forward and you just go, that person has got a certain something. And you might not be able to train that, but I think you can train some of the leadership skills and some of the leadership approaches that are
important. I do understand there's a lot of training goes on in terms of management skills. What I'm talking about is somebody with the innovation, the strategic outlook.
I think you had a comment you had to add, and then Paul, I think, did you want to come in? No, just Stephanie, was it Stephanie? Sorry.
Just a general comment. Scottish Government, quite rightly, have seen school leadership as a key priority, and therefore we've got SCEL, who will be actually looking at developing leaders of the future, and that has the huge potential. To parallel that, Glasgow has what it calls its Aspiring Heads programme, and that's accessible from principal teacher upwards. They're recruited by interview, assessment, and they're invested in over a three-year period. And part of that will be round about, actually, it's not textbook learning, it's about actually being mentored by good head teachers that are already in existence. And you know, I'm still to struggle to actually, what is the formula for good leadership, because you see it in so many different forms. You can have two high-performing schools. It's different type of leadership in both schools, both equally successful, but quite different personalities. Certainly our view would be is that it's actually the more, and certainly the evaluation coming back, is for those aspiring head teachers who are currently principal teachers or deputes, it's that formal linkage with a head teacher mentor that's given the biggest dividends. And sometimes it's not up to about the visionary leadership, it's about the practical day-to-day leadership, about dealing with crisis, dealing with parental concerns, because sometimes that can just be as equally as important in terms of how you engage with your community. The most effective schools are those who are looking out towards their community.
Okay, thank you. Stephanie, I said...
My has been covered, but just one thing I would say, and it's maybe taking it into a slightly broader context, is that if you want to bring good leaders through the system, you'd start at an early age. And certainly things like the Duke of Edinburgh Awards, or things like the leadership qualifications that go on in secondary schools, not just help that young person, but at some point they'll filter in through the system. But my point about scale and things that has been made. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Liam, did you have a quick supplementary here?
I can wrap it into my next question.
And bring in the next one. I think we'll just move on to that stage then. Liam, I'll just bring you in then.
Paul, you mentioned the attainment challenge, and I think clearly that has much to commend it. The concern is that against a backdrop of closing the attainment gap completely, the exclusion of 11 local authorities, and certainly including Gary's and my own, makes it difficult to understand how, without that resource, you're going to be able to address the attainment challenges which exist in Shetland, exist in Orkney, clearly exist in local authorities across the country. So I'm interested to know... how you would see that being addressed. I don't expect you to answer for the government, but in a sense, it does seem the anomaly within a setup that is there partially to deliver the outcome of closing the attainment gap completely.
With that, and obviously, you know, COSLA have expressed concerns in regards to how it's been rolled out. You know, what I can say in terms of the plans that are coming forward with Edinburgh, I'm quite excited about them. I think they will make a benefit. But you know, I'll hand over to Robert because obviously there has been a concern, in terms of COSLA's position in terms of how this has been rolled out across the country.
I mean, I think we've made a few points around the attainment, Chairman. I suppose at one level, any money is welcome, but I suppose there's a couple of points. One, round the scale of the challenge. I think when you look at even 100 million over, I think it's 5 years, that's not to be sniffed at, but you know, small when you compare to what is spent locally on education. But I think it's also that this is very much a schools-based programme. And I think when we've been talking a lot about the other services that go into really helping improvement, not all of which really happen within the school. So clearly there's a concern for us that directing resources specifically at a number of authorities and specifically a number of schools, albeit they may deliver some benefits there, is neglecting those wider services that could do with the investment as well. I think we've also raised concerns just about the nature of how it came about and the fact that it sort of came out without really any local government involvement, and given it's directly at local government, that came as something of a surprise. But you can hear from others how it's going to be spent, and I suspect Glasgow will want to say something about that as well.
I can just add a little bit of context in terms of Edinburgh. You know, across our primary schools, we spend about £3 million a year on what we call positive action funding to tackle poverty and inequality within our schools. The Scottish Attainment Challenge is providing, you know, around about £300,000. So, you know, in terms of scale, in terms of context, you can see there. That's not to say that, you know, that the funding that's been provided won't be put to good use. It undoubtedly will. It will undoubtedly help those children in those situations. But, you know, but it's not a huge amount of funding.
Yeah, I think it's a good point that's raised, and my concern is that actually by not consistently funding all 32 local authorities, we will close the attainment gap, but sadly not in a positive way. We could close the attainment gap, we could do less well, and my fear is that if we see our funding consistently cut, that may be what happens. I mean, my local authority has seen real-term reductions in funding in excess of 25% since 2010, and yet we have managed to maintain and actually increase the percentage of our budget that our remaining budget that we spend in education. So we are trying, but it's getting increasingly more difficult. And like I say, my fear is that our high attainment will come down.
To the agreement around pupil-teacher ratios, I mean, it obviously came up in the context of the pressures that are coming down the track in terms of budget reductions for next year and presumably the years subsequently. George invited a can-do, solutions-oriented approach to this. I mean, presumably you would argue that one of the ways of increasing the likelihood of that were to be to involve greater flexibility around the way in which teacher numbers and teacher ratio, pupil-teacher ratios are managed. And if that's the case, how would you envisage that working?
I think everybody thinks that an education services is dominated by teachers as the predominant workforce, whereas in fact, if you just take a core education service from early years through to additional support for learning, teachers only represent about 50% of the workforce. You know, so it's more than teachers that make an impact and make a difference. And if you asked actually head teachers in terms of would you be resolutely just protect teacher numbers at all costs, I would say the vast majority would say no. It's about the blended workforce that they require in order to do that. And actually, if you think of it in the context of devolved school management, because our hands are tied in terms of protecting teacher numbers, in a scheme of devolved school management, some head teachers are coming up with really weird posts now. So principal teachers of employability and skills. you know, because that's about them aligning to the DYW agenda there, whereas actually they would be better employing somebody with a completely different background, maybe a careers, a Skills Development Scotland type background, employing that directly. Now, let's be crass about it, that would be cheaper than employing a teacher, but you might actually get a better impact and a better outcome as a consequence of it. So teachers are going to be absolutely critical to closing that gap. But it needs to be far more focused in terms of what that blended workforce is. A lot of head teachers in primary schools will tell you, actually, give me more support for learning workers that can actually work more directly with young people in terms of that intervention, and that'll have a better impact than actually just resolutely just making me protect teacher numbers.
I mean, we had a session with some of your colleagues leading up to these evidence sessions. And one of the points that was made was that what the agreement is resulting in is reduction in numbers in terms of classroom assistance, additional support for learning assistance. I mean, they appeared to be talking at that stage about a situation that was already in play rather than one that is likely to emerge with the impending cuts. Are you able to provide any kind of detail around what the impact has been in relation to classroom assistance, additional support for learning assistance?
Drawing on the, it's already been mentioned, the Improvement Service Benchmarking report within there, and I think that does draw on official government statistics. It says since 2010 there's been a reduction in number of support staff in primary school by 3.2% and secondary schools by 8.4%, including a 2.1% reduction in additional support needs staff. It does go on in saying that there's been an actual rise in the number of classroom assistants in there. So these are just statistics, clearly. There could be reasons why that is in there, but it is some information that's already in the public domain.
I wonder if you might be able to talk us through what the implications are in relation to sanctions around teacher numbers, because I think one of the concerns that we've heard is that a failure to hit the teacher numbers may not be the result of a lack of willingness or indeed a lack of attempts to recruit those teachers, but simply an inability to recruit either in specific subjects or across the piece. It'd be helpful maybe to get a better understanding as to what the implications have been for specific local authorities in that respect.
Glasgow, it's quite frustrating because it's census day, so it's a count on a day. And you might get a different number the day after. We were short by 45 teachers. The evidence base was absolutely resolute in terms of where we were going. We actually wanted to over-recruit because of its links in terms of the attainment fund. So we were trying to be ahead of the game in terms of actually recruiting additional teachers. We were short by 45 on the day. That resulted in a £900,000 penalty. You know, which we've had to fund within this year's budget. So there's been a consequence of that in order to do that. The difficulty is, from our point of view, is it's just been our inability to recruit teachers at the time. We cannot get maths, physics, STEM subjects for love nor money. We really struggle in the denominational sector in primary schools. But if you'd actually asked us how many teachers we had 2 weeks on from the September census, we'd be up by about another 35 by that point. So. Right, the census date in September is very difficult in terms of for all local authorities because although you think you've got your schools fully staffed for the end of June, then there's that whole churn over the summer as staff get promoted posts, as they actually decide to take offers in other authorities and whatever. So you're coming back in the middle of August and you've got 2 or 3 weeks to try and get your numbers up.
Relatively straightforward fix, is it not? I mean, that doesn't require a move away either from numbers or indeed from ratio, but simply some way of capturing a point in time assessment, given the implications of falling the wrong side of the line there are so significant. But a point in time assessment is too blunt an instrument that you need something that maybe captures what the situation is over the course of.
I can understand the commitment to maintain teacher numbers, but using the raw tool of census day. Is the wrong tool. I think you should be looking at what our local authority has been doing over the year, in order to do that as well. But to you know, and if you think of the financial burden or penalty that's happened this year, if you look at the agreement for 16-17 and beyond, I mean, you know, some of the penalty could be quite horrendous.
I think the frustration is that it's
an arbitrary figure on a given day. And I don't think that's any way to you know, deliver the outcomes that we both jointly want to see.
Arbitrary?
Well, I mean, I don't know in terms of how the Scottish Government you know, decided the ratio figure. I don't know if there's any research basis that states that that is the optimum amount of staff to deliver the best education for children in Scotland.
And taken right across Scotland as well, I think, if it might, Convenor, I mean, we're at 10 to 1. Are we really going to be penalised if Scotland doesn't make the 13.6 to 1 target overall? I would take serious issue if the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Deputy First Minister, came back to me and said he was going to penalise my council for maintaining the ratio of 10 to 1. That, I think, goes to the sort of arbitrariness that was mentioned. Sorry.
I mean, I think there are two problems. The two problems, one, are there is not consensus around the idea that those pupil-teacher ratios have got any basis in educational attainment, and that there are clearly arguments over that and discussions over that, and different people will take, and different educational experts may take somewhat different positions on it. But there's also then the arbitrary date, and whatever your opinion in terms of pupil-teacher ratios, you could improve what the Scottish Government are attempting to do by finding some way of measuring it over a greater period of time, taking a year average into account rather than a day, fixed date and time, or some other method that takes account of what Ian was describing, that on census day we might be 45 short and 3 weeks later we could be 2+. That just isn't accounted for, and there could be some way of solving that problem, but that doesn't solve the problem of the argument that would come from many local authorities that the pupil-teacher ratios should take account of far wider issues and are, to that extent, also arbitrary.
Okay, thank you. I need to move on. I've got two, they'll have to be quick supplementaries, one from Gordon and one from Liz.
About the teacher number ratio, I mean, Ian, you said you were down 45 teachers, and I think North Lanarkshire was down 58 teachers, yet overall between 2014 and 2015 the number of full-time teachers was down 3 across the whole of Scotland. And I was wanting to ask you about workforce planning. We're in a situation where since 2011 primary school pupils have increased by 30,000 to the projected figure for 2016. We did see a dip in secondary school teachers, secondary school pupils, but that's expected to rise, obviously, because the primary school pupils coming through. So what responsibility have councils got about workforce planning?
Glasgow mirrors that example. Glasgow had 40 years of pupil decline. Yeah. And in the last 5 or 6 years, we've now seen the primary role growing. It's been up 3,000 over the last 4 years. Mm. Over the next decade, it's going to increase by somewhere between 13 and 18%. And, of course, that will flow through into secondary. Mm. Secondary roles at the moment are still dropping. Mm. You know, so what we need is we need more primary school teachers, but less secondary school at the moment. And within that. And, of course, it's a very difficult one, because if you actually think in terms of how the budget settled, it's a cash grant. You know, no recognition of demographic change, in my view, and therefore councils have got really difficult decisions. You know, because they're going to have to find me the money for 50 extra teachers next year just to stand still. You know, that's not an improvement in service. That's just to maintain the current class sizes and the current pupil-teacher ratios. And that's a very difficult circle to square when you're dealing with the type of finances we're dealing with at the moment. And that will be fairly symptomatic across Scotland in terms of the demographics that we're facing at the moment.
To take your point as well, as we do have some chronic workforce issues, you know that. I mean, we struggle to get denominational teachers. There's shortages in STEM, there's shortages in maths. Home economic teachers are as rare as a hen's tooth. I think we need to, at this point in time, stop and have a look nationally. I cannot necessarily go out and recruit these teachers within my local authority. So I think we do need to look at what we're getting in nationally. I mean, even now, I think that the teachers going into English and maths as probationary teachers was falling. So I think we need to look at that nationally. I don't think the solution to workflows planning in the future is actually necessarily local. I think we do need to have a joined-up approach to this to make sure that the people that we're getting through our colleges and universities are what we need.
Liz?
Convener, just on that point, and in relation to what Mr Robertson said, the GTC in Scotland has acknowledged that there are problems, just as you have identified. What can we do to remove some of the inflexibility in the workforce so that we can actually have more teachers in Scotland in the correct subjects?
I mean, the question, I think, is less about flexibility and more about getting prospective teachers through the system. Workforce planning is actually a difficult thing to do. You have to anticipate what you need several years in advance, and it isn't easy. I think no one who's involved in national workforce planning on anything would say that it isn't perfect. What we're currently working with government on, as with ADES, is looking at how we can factor in the vacancies that are already within the system earlier on within the evaluation of workforce planning needs, so that it is really based on a needs-based assessment as to what you actually need, rather than just a sort of calculation on what is required. So clearly, we will need more teachers through the system, whether that's is generated by having more flexibility. In other words, the GTC might argue that's diluting the qualifications of being a teacher. There's arguments you would have to take on board there, but it's more about, have we got the right system in place? Are we encouraging people to being teachers? Can authorities recruit them in time for the people teacher census as well? These are the issues I think we need to be looking at rather than flexibility.
I think just picking up on that point as well, I certainly welcome the recent announcement that North Sea oil workers could be retrained as teachers. I think that's inspired for the simple reason that these people that are losing jobs at the moment probably bring with them exactly the kind of skills that we're looking for in schools at the moment, and that's the STEM subjects. So if that project can actually bear some fruit, then I think that's very positive. And bodes well for actually being able to recruit to what have been difficult to recruit to posts.
Okay, we need to be very brief, Ian. Thanks very much for that. I'm looking at the time here, sorry. Mark.
Thanks, Kevin. I've just got a few questions about efforts to tackle the attainment gap. Just whether members of the panel think that local government and national government's efforts should be targeted in a particular area. I'm thinking about whether it should be targeted at a particular stage in a pupil's education or in a particular subject area, whether that be literacy, numeracy or anything more detailed than that. Any comments in the panel?
No, I don't think so, Mark.
I'm speaking for myself at least, but we're not educationalists. It's hard to answer that in a maybe detailed way. I think what I would say is that you really need to look at the whole child, and you really need to look at what the needs of that that child are, and then it is about making a professional judgment as to what would help that young person do whatever. Do better in whatever they're maybe weaker at, and they're, that might not necessarily be in one like a subject area. It might be more in skills and being able to be ready to be able to learn if they're coming from a chaotic background. I mean, if you're asking about where the evidence sort of points to where you get the biggest return for your investments, shall we say, then it has to be within the early years, and there are a number of studies that look at the investment that the public sector puts into early education, and that does have a sustained return in terms of not just in terms of attainment but wider outcomes around health and well-being as well. So it's really about looking at the whole child and ensuring that professional judgment is brought to bear on what that individual needs.
Okay.
Paul, just to add to that, I think we've obviously had a dialogue with the Scottish Government in terms of what the attainment gap actually is. And, you know, it's not solely defined, and everybody will have a different understanding of what it is and how we fix it. But I agree very much with Robert that, you know, the biggest gains can be made, you know, by looking very much at the early years. And I think that would need to be where our focus is.
Just to make the point again, that, you know, we're talking about a child, you cannot remove the child from the circumstances he or she is in. And if we're talking about things like health and wellbeing, the cross-cutting themes, you'll literacy and numeracy, if you have a child who's coming in from a numerate and illiterate background, you have to tackle the family as well. And again, that's the plea again, that we need to maintain services in there to make sure that our children are benefiting from health and wellbeing, from illiteracy and numeracy cross-cutting themes.
I do have something else that might be helpful, if it is. I just wanted to refer to the OECD report, because that did really look at effectively the situation faced by Scotland. And they did say that there are effectively multiple gaps. And so you can't just focus on attainment and then neglect the fact that there are a wider set of outcomes around that individual child that might need to be improved. And it would be hard to improve attainment if your situation is that you're not able to access learning in the same way as your peers. So it really brings back to the issue of integrated services, getting it right for every child. I mean, we've talked about that for a reason, and ensuring that the services for that individual child are the right ones to ensure that they can continue to develop as individuals, and not just in terms of attainment.
The Parliament recently passed the Education Scotland Bill, and that set out challenges for local government, particularly on reducing the attainment gap. Do you think that the targets that local government have been set are possible? Will local government be able to reduce the attainment gap given the cuts in funding that are coming down the line? Is it feasible to ask local government to deliver that at the same time as cutting budgets?
Gary? I think, again, it comes back to flexibility. I think it could be done, but I do think local government needs more flexibility if they're to deliver on that. I do think it's possible, but challenging, but possible. But it would just be a plea, I think, for more flexibility in order to deliver that.
Possible, but less likely, given the financial circumstances, would be my answer to it. I think everybody's committed to try and achieve it, but in the circumstance it may prove, certainly within that timescale, far more difficult.
I think that is the thing, that, you know, lots of the actions that we are taking, certainly in early years, will not be, you know, we won't see the results of that for many years to come. So it is a very much a long-term project. I think it needs to have a sort of, you know, joint commitment by all parties, you know, across the political divide in terms of the overall aims. But, you know, as fellow colleagues have said, I mean, it is going to be extremely difficult given the circumstances, financial circumstances, that we are in at this point in time.
Colin.
I'm interested in the variation in attainment between schools and between local authorities. The local authority benchmarking notes that the average attainment varies between local authorities and schools, and it's not all due to deprivation levels. In fact, deprivation levels seem to account for approximately 35 to 40% of that gap. And what I'm interested in is, we've got this high level of variation between the councils. So why are some schools, why are some local authorities making better progress than others? Why is this variation there?
I'll come back to the fundamentals again. It's about the quality of leadership and the quality of what goes on in classrooms, full stop. And I think our role as local authorities is to ensure that that we achieve the high performance. So those schools that are not performing as well as they should be, by any measure, that they are challenged to improve, or there have to be changes. We need to be quite clear. My test is always one as a parent. Would I put that? Would I want that teacher there educating my child? If not, they shouldn't be there.
much of this comes down to what actually goes on in a classroom. I have a very good friend of mine who said, if it's not happening in a classroom, then it's not working. And I think this goes back to the quality of our teaching and learning. That's got to be the highest it can be. And that's where things like the GTCS professional update, Higgius 4, all these things are happening. They will come in and they'll make a difference.
To try and get more equality, there needs to be a challenge and support in each local authority. So there needs to be a support that we as education authorities provide to those schools. And obviously, you know, Education Scotland support us, but you know, and when you look at quality improvement officers and you look at the number of quality improvement officers that have been employed, you know, in our authorities, you know, the Audit Scotland report in 2014. You know, states at that point that they had went down by 22%. So, you know, so the budgets that are available to local authorities are directly affecting the support that we can provide to those schools to actually try and sort of even out the performance that you've so rightly identified.
I mean, I hear what you're saying about leadership and the, you know, quality of teaching in the classrooms and so on. But to what extent is this actually being analysed? To what extent are we confident that that is the reason for the balance of the variation? Do we have anything that would underpin that, or is it just anecdotal?
Ian.
Obviously, when you look at raw league tables and here at the bottom, you look at all the other ways to present data to make you look better. And if you actually look at things called like average tariff scores and things like that, and if you actually look at some of what you perceive at face value to be very high performing. Schools in quite affluent areas, if you start looking at tariff scores and you look at schools in less affluent areas, then it does that. So it's a, you know, see that phrase that's used all the time about what added value are you offering? And sometimes, even if that's just data to have a very good conversation with a head teacher, they say, you appear to be performing well, but you appear not to be performing as well as you could or should be relative to the, you know, the demographic you're working with. You know, so we've got to use different measures and different, just to have a conversation and then challenge somebody to say, you look like you're doing really well, but you could be doing better. Absolutely, insight as a tool in which we all use now, it's providing much, much richer data than we've ever had before, that allows us just to get behind that that raw, blunt instrument of you know, exam result success.
But still, coming back to this variation, I mean, there doesn't seem to be a pattern here looking at it from the outside. You've got councils with high levels of overall deprivation performing above average. You've got councils with low levels of deprivation where pupils from deprived backgrounds are performing above average. It's not really giving us any data to work on. There's no consistency.
I mean, I think some of this comes back to the SIMS data that's at the basis of all of this. And speaking as someone that comes from a rural authority, I find SIMS data is worse than useless in terms of determining poverty. It's fine, maybe not, in Ian's case in Glasgow, where you can identify a large area that suffers from deprivation. But in rural areas, some of the poorest and most deprived people stay next door to some of the wealthiest. And it's absolutely impossible in rural areas to use SIMS to actually identify areas of deprivation. So I think there's something here around actually getting the right data in the first place.
Sorry, to interrupt, but isn't that the point Colin just made? That, you know, we've got pupils who are in areas of relatively well-off, least deprived areas, but they themselves are, would fall into the most deprived category, but they are doing better than average. They're doing better than pupils like themselves in other authorities. Mm-hmm. Why is that?
I think for factors that have already been described, I mean, clearly Glasgow is large enough to have a fair spread of attainment between the various schools, whether that's primary or secondary within the city itself. And, looking at raw statistical analysis is not enough. For example, in Govan Hill, we have a hugely significant Roma community, which has a knock-on effect in terms of both the costs and the process of delivering education within two or three local primary schools. But those figures never come in to Sims. They're just not there. They're not taken account of. And what you need to know are additional things. And it's not only in education that that happens. I mean, until recently, I had responsibility for social work in Glasgow City Council. And if you look to all sorts of comparators, as we always do between local authorities. For example, the number of elderly people in residential care, Glasgow is very high, as is, I think, Shetland. But if you look at the there is no direct connection with poverty. There are other issues going on, and they're not always easily determined.
I think the other thing, if I could just come back, is our definition of poverty. Because work that Highlands and Islands Enterprise recently did through the minimum income standard that looked at cost of living, basic cost of living across the Highlands and Islands, suggested that, for example, in the island of Unst in Shetland, the cost of living, the basic cost of living, could be 40% higher than it was in the central belt of Scotland. Now, if you factor that in, somebody the thresholds for benefits are the same in Shetland as they are in Glasgow. The levels of benefits are the same in Shetland as they are in Glasgow. Then you can see why this huge amount of disparity starts to come, because somebody that needs 40% more in Balticent to maintain the same standard of living is going to be deprived actually before the person in Glasgow. But they're not going to be picked up because they're in an island that barely has 250 people.
I think possibly the frustration here is that clearly there's some councils that are getting it right on average within their area, but we don't have enough data to be able to understand, to be able to transfer that success to other areas. It's just not there.
I think that's an honest, if we're responding honestly, to say that I think that's indeed the case. I suppose what we would say is that I don't think there are, just from knowing the people, there's nobody in a local authority who isn't working their hardest to actually get a result. Part of the reason you have this information put into the public domain is to beg the questions you're asking. That's a perfectly legitimate thing to do. I mean, clearly something like the National Improvement Framework, even though we've been reasonably sceptical about some elements of that, when that is brought to bear, will provide more information about how councils are able to tackle the issues that we're discussing, and that is all fine. But clearly, then we need to decide what we're going to be doing with that. As we've talked about before, the capacity within councils has to be there to be able to tackle these issues, and that's an issue the OECD pick up as well, because they also look at the issue of variation between councils. But what they're saying is you need that capacity at the middle level within the system to be able to really tackle attainment and have that ability to look at the things you need to look at and invest the time and effort to do that. So there isn't a simple solution to it, but partly for having that sort of information is to allow the questions to be asked and then the policy to develop to be able to tackle that.
I'm curious about I'm not sure I agree with Colin there about the devil of, I think we have got quite a lot of data, even down to school and individual level. Sorry, Ian, did you want to come in?
The insight tool. I'm a bit rusty here in terms of my last time with it. But right across Scotland, each secondary school, for example, we'd be linked with five comparator schools based on its socioeconomic circumstances. And what you'd be comparing there, relatively speaking, would be how are you performing relative to similar characteristic schools across the country. And from recollection, it was about four or five you're linked with. And those head teachers were actually quite working cooperative to understand, well, why are your physics results so good compared to, and things like that. So they were getting into really granular conversations around about what was making an impact. And invariably, it keeps coming back to the quality of what's going on in a classroom. Sometimes it's about teaching methodologies, et cetera, et cetera. But the bottom line is it's about the quality of that. But
I think it's about how we use that data, and it's about the difficulty of aggregating that up. Because I think at a very localised level, I think the schools and head teachers are far more aware of how they are performing relative to their peers, and not necessarily, you know, within their geography. It could be somebody in Aberdeenshire that you're being compared with, and I think that's good and healthy.
No, I think it is, and I think that was the point I was trying to get to, effectively, that I think we have got some of that stuff, and it's not to criticise, because I think everybody is working hard, and I think Robert made a very good point there. But there is still this variation. We need to recognise it, and we need to work to try and understand it and hopefully eliminate it. And I think that's kind of maybe a good point to end on. listen, just because of time, but I mean, I know there's an awful lot more we could have got through this morning, but just time's against us. Can I thank you once again for coming along this morning, giving your time to the committee, and I'll suspend briefly. Thank you.
Our next item is to take evidence on school spending and the educational attainment gap from the Scottish Government. Can I welcome Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning, and our supporting officials. And as soon as the Cabinet Secretary is ready, you okay? Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Committee. Very much welcome this opportunity to join Committee again to discuss our ongoing work, the ongoing work of this Government to address the attainment gap in our schools. This Government has been absolutely clear about the priority that we place on education. It is at the heart of our programme for Government, with our commitment to drive up attainment in all schools and close the attainment gap to ensure that children in all parts of Scotland, whether in our least or our most affluent areas, have a fair chance to succeed. We are working very closely with all our key delivery partners to raise standards everywhere and to raise them most quickly in the areas where it is most needed. That's why we've established the Attainment Scotland Fund, providing £100 million of targeted support to schools and local authorities in the most deprived areas. And that is in addition to the package of universal support in place to support schools and authorities across the country, including the recruitment of attainment advisers to work with schools and Raising Attainment for All programme, which has encouraged more than 200 schools across the country to try out and share ideas. So this is a significant programme of work, which is underpinned by the National Improvement Framework for Scottish Education, which will provide clear and consistent information for parents, for teachers, and of course for local and national government about performance in education, both the progress of individual young people and the performance of the system as a whole. The changes that we're making, Convener, through our investment are having an impact, and we are making good progress. And the OECD study of Scottish education published just before Christmas concluded that academic achievement in schools is above international average, that attainment is improving, that Scotland's schools are inclusive, and that our young people have positive attitudes towards school. And as we know, young people in Scotland gained a record number of passes at higher and advanced higher last summer, and school leaver destinations are now the best on record. It is worth noting that much of our funding for education is, of course, directed through our funding package for local government. Within the local government settlement, education is a priority. We remain committed to teacher numbers, and the settlement includes provision of £88 million specifically to support delivery of the commitment to maintain the pupil-teacher ratio and provide a place on the teacher induction scheme to every probationary teacher who needs one. Teacher quality is the most important in-school factor in a child's attainment, and I do not believe that cutting the number of teachers will improve attainment or close the equity gap. We are investing in our schools. We have rebuilt or refurbished 607 schools. As a result of that, the number of pupils in poor or bad condition schools has more than halved since 2007. And we are continuing our major investment in Scotland's school estate through the £1.8 billion Scotland Schools for the Future programme, where national and local government will work in partnership to deliver more than 100 new or refurbished schools, which is expected to benefit 15,000 pupils. So closing the attainment gap is a fundamental part to the ongoing work to improve Scottish education, to ensure excellence and equity right across Scotland. And that's why we'll continue to invest in our schools, our teachers, and most importantly, in our children and young people.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, moving straight on to questions, can I call George Adam?
Cabinet Secretary, we had representatives of local authorities in just before yourself, and one of the things that it's interesting to hear you say that you don't believe that cutting teacher numbers would help bridge the attainment gap, because one of the things that local authorities kept saying that they felt that they were losing a bit of flexibility been able to. Teacher numbers were actually regarded as part of the problem that they had with their flexibility. What would be your what would your counter-argument be to that? They were saying teacher numbers and some of the other government kind of tasks have been making it more difficult for them to be as flexible.
I think we all recognise, and I would hope that our partners in local government would recognise this too. I know that members right across the parliamentary chamber recognise that, you know, one of the most important factors in raising attainment is the quality of teaching. That's why, as a government, we have invested heavily into leadership and the quality of teaching in Scotland. And to put it quite simply, I fail to see how reducing the number of high-quality teachers in our schools, how that would help us at this time when we are galvanising our efforts, the length and breadth of Scotland, to tackle the attainment gap and to address the issue of equity. Good quality teachers are imperative, and I fail to see how reducing the number of good quality teachers in an education system, how that would be to the benefit of anyone.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. One of the interesting points was when I asked them to, you know, where was the innovation, where was the new ideas in local government for the education delivery, you know, they actually became very positive at that point, and they started talking about some of the work that they do currently do within their own authorities. But the thing that kept coming out and the thing that kept coming across was there tends to be almost like exam time covering of the paper. You know, it's my ball. You know, there doesn't seem to be that kind of sharing of that good practice and some of these good schemes, you know. And well, I think one of the individuals from Glasgow actually said that, you know, yeah, sometimes you do kind of hold on to good stuff that was working well in your area because you want to be the innovator. But surely local authorities at this time, these challenging times, you know, surely they should be sharing these ideas to make things better so that we can deliver across Scotland.
I think it's absolutely clear that collaboration has to be front and centre of Curriculum for Excellence. Collaboration has to be at the heart of our efforts to close the attainment gap. It's certainly at the heart of our thinking in terms of how we're progressing with the Scottish Attainment Challenge, because the work that we're doing there and the learning that we will gain from that work through the efforts of Education Scotland and the National Improvement Hub, we will want to spread that knowledge and that learning that we gain from the attainment challenge. But it is clear to me, you know, I mean, I visit schools regularly. It is clear to me that we have good schools and they're doing great things. And in that regard, our colleagues in local government are absolutely correct. And while we have more collaboration, you know, between schools and clusters, peer-to-peer collaboration than we've ever had before. I mean, it is clear that we need to, you know, continue on that vein. And much of our attraction to the London Challenge, for example, was that ownership, that you weren't just responsible for the children in front of you, that collectively everyone in the system, including teachers, you had a responsibility to raise attainment, in this case across London. So we're wanting everyone in Scotland, whether they're a classroom teacher or, you know, someone else in the education system, that actually we're trying to galvanise efforts so that we share good practice and that we're driving improvement across Scotland, and that we all have a responsibility to do that.
Looking to the future, Cabinet Secretary, obviously the goal is to close the attainment gap. What measures would the Scottish Government and Education Scotland have if there's local authorities that in the future possibly still persist to have the gap and others are doing well? You know, would it be a case of Education Scotland trying to find other local authorities who are an exemplar in it to try and work something out? You know, how would we deal with that situation in the future?
I think it's important that as a government, it's important that organisations like Education Scotland, that we are pulling together with our partners in local government, that we work together in our common challenges, you know, to overcome, you know, the barriers and the obstacles. I think in terms of specific measures, the duties that both Scottish ministers and local authorities have in terms of annual reporting as to how we are overcoming the equity gap. I mean, we all have duties as a result of the Education Scotland Act, duties, inequalities of outcome duties. And part of the reporting responsibilities, as I say, both in Scottish ministers and on councils, will aid with accountability, transparency. The onus will be on, you know, local and national government to report not just in a way that's describing what they're doing, but evaluating what they're doing, explaining, you know, what works, you know, identifying the future challenges. I think that's important. I think our approach to the Attainment Scotland Fund has been quite different from other initiatives. We haven't just, you know, calculated, you know, a share of funds to go to a particular school or a particular local authority. The funding is very much tied in with bespoke improvement plans that are evidence-led. We will have opportunities in terms of implementing the recommendations from the OECD report to be doing that in partnership with local government. In terms of how we move forward with the National Improvement Framework, again, you know, we'll be doing that with local government. So there's lots of, you know, opportunities for mutual support, I suppose mutual challenge as well, and shining a light on what's working and, you know, where we need to redouble our efforts.
Thank you.
Lee MacArthur.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
I was interested, you started there describing the central importance of the quality of teaching, and I think that very much reflects what we heard from the first panel this morning. That and leadership, I think, was a theme that came up time and time again. But you then effortlessly went into describing the need to maintain the quantity of teachers, and I think the conflating of those two things is rather disingenuous. I think the point we were hearing this morning was that, for example, the establishment of the pupil-teacher ratio has struck many in local government as arbitrary, not backed necessarily by any evidence. And the arbitrary nature of that, linked to the arbitrary nature of a point-in-time census calculation as to whether or not they hit their teacher targets, is causing real problems, as George says, a lack of flexibility, which in difficult times is proving even more problematic and putting more stress on, for example, classroom assistants, additional support for learning assistants, and the others who provide vital support in the quality of teaching, which, as you rightly say, is important. So I think there's a concern here that the issue of quality and quantity are being merged when actually they are very, very distinct propositions, and in tight budget circumstances that lack of flexibility means yes, the quality needs to be maintained, but there are questions about the arbitrary quantum that the government arrived at.
Yeah. I think they are related. I think, you know, quantity and quality. I mean, I accept, you know, I understand the theoretical point that Mr. MacArthur is trying to make to tease out and to explore matters fully. But I do think, you know, ultimately they are related. Given that we all agree that, you know, leadership, all levels in education, leadership and classroom teachers, that the quality of teaching and quality professionals is a linchpin. It is the biggest factor in terms of a child's in-school experience. I just fail to see how standing back and allowing those numbers to reduce, to fall, how that would help us, you know, in our collective efforts.
blended learning there, where teachers are by their own admission, reliant on classroom assistance and the wider support structure that they get within a school. And actually the quality of the learning and the teaching isn't dependent on the number of teachers alone. Presumably, once you get beyond a certain point, the whole thing becomes unmanageable. But actually, the quantity that has been arrived at in terms of pupil-teacher ratios to local authorities seems arbitrary. It doesn't allow them to reflect local circumstances in particular areas or in particular schools. And that at this current time, it would be a far better proposition to allow that greater flexibility to focus on the quality of the teaching and the learning experience rather than on arbitrary numbers of teachers or pupil-teacher ratios.
I mean, I was coming to your point about pupil-teacher ratio, but I suppose the point that I wanted to make before I did that, Mr. MacArthur, is that as a government, we have a lead responsibility in workforce planning, in ensuring that we have enough teachers in the system. And of course, we work closely with our partners, you know, in their attempts to ensure that we've got the right number of teachers, you know, in the right places. So, you know, I'm just very resistant to this notion that the quantity of teachers is separate from the issue of quality. Actually, it has to be about both. Now, in terms of pupil-teacher ratio, we have reached an agreement with local government to this year have a national agreement on the pupil-teacher ratio. You know, that is, you know, preferable for a whole host of reasons, as opposed to having individual agreements with local authorities, where that will indeed limit the flexibility that local authorities have. And the point about census is that there has to be a way of counting teachers in the system. And the school census day, I appreciate it's, you know, a day in September every year, is how we've done it since 2003. Now, if people want to come forward with other suggestions and other alternatives about how we count the number of teachers at any given time in our system, you know, we're always open to that dialogue.
The idea was being, I think, put forward by the gentleman from Glasgow City Council, that actually moving away from a single point in time census date and actually looking at the picture over the course of over a school year or even over a school term may provide less of an arbitrary picture, where he was saying they were 45 teachers short on census day, but actually over the course of that term they were probably at their numbers. Nevertheless, they're fined £900,000, which against the backdrop of cuts that are already being borne by education services and local authorities is the last thing they need, and unlikely to allow them to deliver across a range of different services in education and children's services. So it just seems to me that we've arrived at a situation where, even in terms of achieving the government's objective, it's a very kind of blunt instrument that's being used to determine whether or not it's successful.
I think it is widely recognised that pupil-teacher ratio is a, you know, meaningful measurement. In terms of your point about, you know, an alternative to, you know, a census gathering exercise, I mean, you describe something that, on first hearing to me, you know, sounds quite unwieldy, and I'm not actually convinced that local government information systems could cope with what you've described in terms of having a system that, you know, almost counted the number of professionals in the system at various points in time, you know, over a term. I wouldn't be confident about that at all. Hmm.
So are you finished?
Yeah.
Thank you. Liz.
Quickly, Cabinet Secretary, could you tell us what the evidence base was that made you decide that the pupil-teacher ratio was the best way of making an agreement with councils to deliver better quality of input?
Well, the pupil-teacher ratio is obviously based on where we're at just now. And we have arrived at that position for a whole host of historical reasons. We know that the work of McKinsey in 2007 very much focuses on the importance of quality of teaching. We know we have quality teachers in our system. We have invested heavily in that in terms of initial teacher education, in terms of probationary years and the support that probationary teachers get, in terms of the registration process and thereafter the professional update. And, you know, if we don't protect pupil-teacher ratio nationally, what does that mean for our system? That would mean that we would be liable to reducing the number of high-quality teachers in our system, and that can't be a good thing, and there isn't any evidence to show that that would be... That that would be.
So just to clarify, it's the McKinsey evidence that makes you believe that the evidence is there for supporting your view?
It's informed my thinking. You know, while I'm not saying the McKinsey evidence, you know, gives you a specific answer that the pupil-teacher ratio should be, you know, 14 to 1, you know, across Scotland. But in terms of the importance of having quality teachers in our system, it's certainly very solid evidence. And if we don't protect the pupil-teacher ratio as it is, if we allow the pupil-teacher ratio to increase, that will be as a result of a falling number of quality teachers in our system, and that just can't be a good thing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. And I apologise, I'm going to have to leave at 10 past 12. Cabinet Secretary, last week I had the pleasure of a long conversation with someone who is at the coalface in education, and that was my seven-year-old granddaughter. And we talked about, you know, the roles that she goes through and the testing that she goes through to determine how well she is achieving. We had written to the Scottish Government noting that attainment tends to be measured in terms of examination results, and I had that conversation with her and how it impacts the various members of the class. And if you're doing well, that's fine. If you're not doing well, then, you know, it causes some problems for those that are not doing well. The other thing we talked about was, while it's comparatively straightforward to compare the performance of different groups of pupils in tests or examinations on a national basis, we still have some question as to how do we measure achievement. So I wonder how pupils, parents and education stakeholders will know for certain when the attainment gap has been closed, and whether closing the attainment gap also means closing the achievement gap, and if so, whether there's an agreed measure or definition of the achievement gap.
Okay. Speaking to seven-year-olds is always instructive. I have regular representations from my eight-year-old about what he would like to see changed in education in Scotland. All of his requests have been refused, I hasten to add. I think it's an important point. We've always been clear as a government that attainment is something beyond exam results or school leaver destinations. I know that in terms of various academics, I know in terms of the OECD report, which quite helpfully, I suppose, laid out the theoretical difference between, you know, attainment and wider achievement, in terms that, you know, achievement is about, you know, the experiences young people get, you know, the knowledge and skills that they acquire, and, you know, attainment traditionally has been very much focused on exam results. And in terms of our work, I mean, they are, I suppose, they're different things, but they are inextricably linked as well, and that, you know, you improve the attainment of children if you're also supporting their social and emotional well-being, and, you know, considering their needs in the broadest term. I suppose I would like to point committee to the interim framework report that was published just before Christmas, And there's a range of information there from the Grown Up Scotland survey, SSLN, school leaver destinations exams, PISA. Also has a range of information about health and wellbeing. And as we move forward, obviously, there's the Scottish Standardised Assessment that will be introduced. But we're working very closely with our partners to get the right measurements. And a lot of stakeholders have been very excited and interested in the work that we wish to pursue around a dashboard, because on the one hand, we don't want to have too few measurements because we'll then have teaching to targets, but neither, you know, do we want a kind of unwieldy and complex system of measurement. We have the challenge from OECD that said we have to identify the right metrics that reflects the breadth of our curriculum. So in that work that we're progressing, you know, over the next year or so, we will identify the meaningful, you know, milestones that will signpost the way to closing the attainment gap, so that, you know, we come to the point when we know that we have, you know, closed the attainment gap. And that is inextricably linked also to addressing issues in and around achievement as well, and that broader experience.
It's very helpful, but it comes back to the issue of being able to measure the attainment gap, which tends to be a standardised assessment, which is transmogrified into there will be tests which have, you know, on any one day, depends on the emotional circumstances of those at the coalface, i.e. The children that are going through the education experience. And I'm still, well, as I say, it's very helpful that we're going to have this dashboard of criteria of attainment. I'm still not sure, and I'm glad that we're not talking about targets anymore. I'm not sure how we're actually going to, how do we measure the achievement gap? And if that's a sort of esoteric question, then, you know, I'm happy to leave it and then perhaps have further discussions later. But I'm still not sure whether closing the attainment gap means closing the achievement gap, and how do we measure that?
Yeah. No, I mean, it's not an esoteric question. I mean, I suppose I just have to be clear that we are not measuring the attainment gap in terms of, you know, assessment or testing. You know, the standardised assessment is part of a broad range of information that will be gathered and used to evaluate performance. What will be published is curriculum for excellence levels. You know, the proportion of children at P1, 4, 7 and S3 that meet the relevant curriculum for excellence level. That, of course, you know, is one measurement. I suppose in terms of your broader question about, you know, how do we know when we have closed the equity gap? I mean, what we have been clear about is that we are using the SIMD index, and, you know, we've opted for that, and I know, you know, there's been discussion, you know, not everybody is completely in favour of that measurement. I know some people have concerns about how it, you know, picks up, you know, rural poverty, but we've opted to use the SIMD as a methodology because it captures, you know, a range of incomes, and we are not just looking at children, a kind of binary definition of children who are, you know, advantaged or disadvantaged. So we can look at, you know, the 10% most disadvantaged and compare with the 10% least disadvantaged, you know, or, you know, the 20% least and most disadvantaged. And we can also see, you know, what's happening to children in the middle income deciles as well. And it is fair to say, and I think Mr. Brodie alluded to it, that there are many different gaps and through the education bill that we have, you know, recently unanimously endorsed, the focus, you know, the primary focus is on socioeconomic disadvantage, therefore, you know, the importance of the Scottish Index of multiple deprivation. But there are other gaps that exist, and, you know, we're on record, I'm on record, as having a willingness through regulation to, you know, extend our measures and our duties, you know, to those other gaps. I mean, we have the gender gap, although girls outperform boys. You know, if you look at additional support needs, looked after children, I mean, there are other gaps. And there is a willingness to, you know, extend as time goes by. But we really need to galvanise those efforts in looking at the poverty-related gap.
Thank you. Very helpful. Thank you.
Liam McArthur.
Convener. We've talked again about closing the attainment gap, and I share, I think, a lot of Chick's kind of confusion around what it is that we're talking about. And clearly, there are multiple gaps. The OECD policy review says there is not one gap, but many. The language of the gap may misleadingly suggest that it's self-evident which gap should be the main target, or that one gap may stand as an adequate proxy for many others. Given that the government has committed itself to closing the gap completely, do you not think that there are risks there that gauging the success of that is going to be nigh on impossible, because we're not even accepting in the commitment that's been made the existence of those multiple gaps?
No, I mean, I think we are accepting that there are, you know, various gaps. They are interlinked and related often. But the National Improvement Framework, I mean, has made very clear what our priorities are. And, you know, given the impact and size of the poverty-related gap, I think we are quite right in terms of that being the starting point and focus of the National Improvement Framework in the first instance. I mean, we've already given an indication that we will, you know, quickly, you know, wanting to be looking at what more we can do around the gap, the education gap, in and around looked after children. But I think it's important to start to get the building blocks absolutely right, and then, you know, to refine and to add to the framework.
But in a sense, we started from the position of oversimplifying the problem that we're trying to deal with, and that doesn't seem to me a sensible way of going about addressing what is, by everybody's acknowledgement, the most complex of issues that is affected by multiple factors, some of which you've acknowledged, and yet the government is committed to closing this attainment gap completely, and will be measured on its success in doing that. Mm-hmm. And I think, as a committee, certainly from my perspective, I have no idea what the measurements along the way to achieving that commitment are.
Mm-hmm. I mean, in terms of the priorities laid out in the National Improvement Framework, I mean, there is a particular focus on literacy and numeracy, and obviously as part of Curriculum for Excellence, literacy and numeracy has to be embedded in every part of the curriculum. I mean, they're not taught in silos. We've been very clear that, you know, we're looking, when we talk about closing the gap, we are talking about closing the gap between the children from the least and most disadvantaged. And yes, that's ambitious. And actually, you know, that's harder than, you know, a more binary, you know, calculation of, you know, looking at children, you know, that are, you know, disadvantaged or not. So we have set ourselves, you know, a high bar. We're also, you know, as indicated to Mr. Brodie, you know, there's a real focus on improving children's, you know, health and well-being. their employability skills, and of course sustaining, you know, positive school leaver destinations are important as well. But I mean, I go back to the point with regards to SIMD, that we're not comparing the 50% most disadvantaged to the 50% least disadvantaged. The advantage of SIMD is that, you know, it has 10 deciles, and we're looking at, you know, the least disadvantaged compared with the most disadvantaged, and we will know that the gap is closed when, you know, there is no gap between the least and the most disadvantaged.
That presupposes the SMID 20 picks up those who are living in absolute poverty and who are most profoundly affected by poverty. And I think the evidence, again, we heard this morning from Gary Robinson at Shetland Islands Council, is that SMID does not pick up particularly rural poverty. He cited the example of Unst, where the cost of living is estimated to be around 40% higher than the national average. Now, when you consider that benefits are the same across the UK, where income is measured and how SMID is calculated, it doesn't factor in that additional cost of living, then anybody living in poverty in somewhere like Baltusound is simply not going to be picked up on them.
I mean, what I would contend, Convener, is while SIMD is not perfect, I don't think any single measurement is perfect. I mean, that's the whole purpose of the National Improvement Framework, that it's broad.
I think it's
the best that is available just now. I would never argue that any single measurement, you know, is perfect. But I think, for example, using SIMD is preferable to looking at free school meal entitlement, given that free school meal entitlement is universal in primary 1, 2, and 3.
Down to a single metric, which is, again, one of the concerns we've heard from witnesses, that if you oversimplify the problem, the risk is you apply metrics that are going to be blunt. They are going to miss out, and SMID 20 is a classic example. It will underplay the existence and the severity of rural poverty.
But I think, you know, that's why, as I alluded to earlier, you know, we're taking on the recommendations from the OECD report that says that we have to develop the right metrics that reflect the curriculum and, you know, measure, you know, accurately and proportionately, you know, the outcomes that we're trying to achieve in the curriculum. I mean, you know, I mean, I appreciate the discussion and the debate around SIMD, but I mean, the National Improvement Framework, in terms of, you know, the range, you know, of information used to evidence, you know, the size of, you know, the current equity gap, is broad range. I mean, I quoted earlier, you know, the Grown Up in Scotland report, quoted earlier the SSLN report, and looking at that in terms of SIMD, you know, there was also other evidence used in terms of PIPs, you know, as well as the traditional, you know, exam results and PISA results. So, you know, we've started from quite a broad basket of measurements. I accept that, you know, in terms of Grown Up in Scotland, you know, when you analyse school leaver destinations, that, yeah, we're often looking at that through the prism of the Scottish Index of multiple deprivation. I would contend that while it's not a perfect measurement, it's the best one that we have.
But it's one that you would...
Whatever goes out, Liam, and time-wise, I've got a number of members to get in. I'm going to have to move on. Apologies, but John.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure you're aware of Labour's Fair Start Fund, where every primary school in the country would receive an extra £1,000 for each pupil from a deprived background. You know, where my own authority, for example, North Lanarkshire, would receive an additional £5 million from that fund. I'm sure you're also aware that the Scottish Government's Attainment Challenge Fund, 1,500 schools get no support whatsoever to close that gap between the richest and the rest. So do you, Cabinet Secretary, think it's right that a pupil from a deprived background is missing out on support to improve their life chances because of where they live?
No, and we have Mr. Pentland embarked upon a journey where we are picking up the pace, where we are determined to ensure that the children most in need actually get access to the resources that they need through the attainment challenge. Now, that's not the only way of funding. I mean, there are other streams of funding, but through the attainment challenge, the first step of the attainment challenge was to target seven local authorities from the smallest in Clackmannanshire to the largest in Glasgow, North Lanarkshire, as part of the attainment challenge. And those seven local authorities collectively have more than half of Scotland's poorest children. In recognition that, you know, indeed there are children from, you know, poor backgrounds in every school in every part of Scotland, the next phase was the more specific schools part of the attainment challenge, which was focusing on schools who had 70% of their children in SIMD deciles 1 and 2. The attainment challenge now covers 21 local authorities at 300 plus schools. We've got an OECD recommendation that is saying that we should look at extending the attainment challenge to secondary schools, and we are indeed doing that. But there are other, you know, parts, you know, aspects of our funding, you know, whether it's the innovation fund, whether it's the access to education fund. And, you know, we have a strong universal offer, and, you know, where we have to focus our efforts is to ensure that in terms of building on that strong universal offer, that we target in the right way and in the most effective way. And the approach that we have taken is to target local authorities and to target schools.
Do you not then think, Cabinet Secretary, that you're being unfair to those schools who are not eligible for any kind of support whatsoever? How are you then going, you know, how are you going to then maintain the attainment gap? How are you going to improve the attainment gap? Why are these schools having to wait? You know, you say you have a universal approach to this. If you've got a universal approach to this, why are not all those schools included just now?
Included in the universal approach. I mean, we have funded attainment advisors, for example, to work with every local authority. There is the National Improvement Hub, which has been set up by Education Scotland to ensure that best practice and actually the learning from the Scottish Attainment Challenge, because there will be learning from the Attainment Challenge that is absolutely crucial in terms of setting the direction and setting the pace as we, you know, move forward. And I suppose, you know, what I'm questioning, Mr. Pentland, is not it's not your sincerity ensuring that the most vulnerable children receive the support that they need, but I am with respect querying you know, proposals as set out by Scottish Labour in terms of their effectiveness.
So when you have said then, Cabinet Secretary, that, you know, that there are deprived children in each school, you know, obviously, you know, associated to that is these people need help, these kids need help, the schools need help to close the attainment gap. So my question to you is, when do you foresee that opportunity for these schools who are not part of everything that you've just said there, when will they receive the financial help to assist them to close the attainment gap?
Well, we have a very strong offer to all schools. We've prioritised funding to ensure that we continue to invest in the teaching workforce, that we are continuing to protect teacher numbers, because that's important to all children, and particularly so children who are, you know, also living with disadvantaged. As I said, we have funded attainment advisors. measures. There's the National Improvement Hub. There's the Raise and Attainment for All programme with more than 200 schools participating. Some of this is about what we do with a resource. Some of this is about, you know, what we do in terms of delivering that universal service. We know that attainment over the past decade has increased. We know that there is already evidence of closing the attainment gap. So there is, you know, a body of evidence and measurements that indicate that we are on the right road, whether it's with school leaver destinations at a record high. We know that the gap in school leaver destinations is closing. We know in terms of young people from the most disadvantaged communities in terms of achieving 1+ higher, that is improving. It used to be 2 out of 10 young people. That is now nearly 4 out of 10 young people from disadvantaged backgrounds achieving 1+ higher. But you know, we're absolutely determined to increase that pace. And, you know, the overarching framework is indeed the National Improvement Framework that gives us that line of sight from what's happening in a classroom to the evaluation of policies and approaches at a local and a national level, with the obligation on Scottish ministers and local government to report and to be accountable for the effectiveness of their actions.
Very quick, John. Yeah.
Would you therefore concede then, Cabinet Secretary, that Scottish Labour's Fair Start Fund would close attainment gap quicker than the Scottish Government's Attainment Challenge Fund?
No, I don't, Mr Pentland, because I remain yet to be convinced about how you would fund it if you were ever in the position to implement it. So at that point, I think we're just going to have to disagree.
We've already advised how we'd fund it.
The election's soon, I know, guys, but let's try and stick to the report this morning. Mark.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you said in your opening remarks that cutting teachers will not cut the equity or attainment gap. And similarly, I would say that cutting education budgets will not cut the equity or attainment gap. Are you concerned by the comments by our earlier panel that local government feel that the Scottish Government are making it more difficult to close the attainment gap? They said that the budget cuts the Scottish Government are handing down to them are making their job more difficult to cut the attainment or equity gap. Do you not see it as a strange position where the Government's overriding priority from you and the First Minister to cut that attainment gap when the people you're asking to deliver that in priority say that you're making their job harder?
Well, of course, most local authorities are still to actually set their budget. I think it's fair to say that for everyone, whether it's the Scottish Government or any one of the 32 local authorities, that public finances are challenging, they remain challenging, they've been challenging for some years. Much of the funding for education, as I said in opening remarks, is channelled through the local government settlement, which I would contend is a fair settlement. We would acknowledge that it is not without its challenges, but in reality, every local authority has accepted the budget settlement, and the reduction is of less than 1% once you include other resources in terms of investment into integration of health and social care. And the reality is that despite the challenging financial times that we've all faced at a local and national level, attainment has increased and the gap has closed. And the challenge for us all is to re-galvanise our efforts, to pick up the pace, and to recognise that we are still investing, or what's invested at a local level, is nearly £5 billion in education.
So you don't agree with the comments from the previous panel from local government that the Scottish Government are making it harder for them to reduce the attainment gap?
No, I don't agree with that at all, Mr Griffin. I mean, as I've hoped that I've outlined this morning, that there's a range of activity and a range of efforts and a real willingness on the part of this government to work in partnership with everyone at every level in education in Scotland to overcome the barriers and the interests of all children. The financial realities are challenging for local and national government. But the reality is we both have a job of work to do and we need to crack on with it whilst we all recognise the financial constraints. But we need to focus on what we can do with the resources that we do have. And I go back to my earlier point, Convener, that despite the challenging financial times that we have all lived through, attainment is increasing and the gap is closing, and we need to continue on that vein.
You've spoken about the financial situation that we find ourselves in, but some of your Cabinet colleagues have been successful in getting protection for particular areas of their budget, and I think particularly about policing and the NHS. Have you pressed the Cabinet Secretary for protection for the schools budget?
I'm probably the bane of the finance minister's life, as I've always been in every capacity that I've ever served this government in. But I'm very proud of this government's record. In terms of my portfolio, there will be an investment of £2.9 billion that will continue our endeavours in the early years, endeavours to close the gap, and the work that we're doing in colleges and in higher education. So I think there is a good budget settlement for education in terms of my portfolio, in terms of Scottish government spend. And, as I said earlier, it has to be recognised that much of the funding for education is channelled through the local government settlement.
But would you not prefer to see the schools budget, the budget that you're responsible for, protected? In a similar basis as the other Cabinet Secretaries have been able to secure for their budgets?
Well, you know, I've just been challenged earlier by members who are picking up, reiterating some of the arguments from COSLA objecting to the measures that we've taken to protect the pupil-teacher ratio and the investment in that. Are you suggesting that we ring-fence other aspects of the education budget?
I'm suggesting that other Cabinet Secretaries have protected spending in their areas. That will mean that non-protected areas of spending over the next 5 years will be reduced by in the order of 16%. That's, if you apply that to local government and education budgets, that's looking at an £800 million cut over the next 5 years to education budgets. Are you not concerned by that, and would you not seek protection for the school's budget and your portfolio, as other Cabinet Secretaries have successfully done in their areas?
Well, I mean, I would query your figures, Mr Griffin, because we've only set a one-year budget, and I think any projection into future years is a complete work of fiction. In terms of my portfolio and the budget, in terms of the education and lifelong learning budget, in terms of the resource that goes to out the door on services or in work on improving services and outcomes, there has been a modest increase, and given the financial challenges, I think a modest increase of around 1% is to be welcomed.
Gordon, I need a very brief supplementary.
We're talking about cuts to local government budget, and yet we're in a situation where we are in a difficult financial situation. But looking at the Spice briefing, it says that in 1999, when devolution started, the local government share of total Scottish government budget was 36.2%. 2007-08, it was 35.9%. And 2015-16, is 36%. That seems to me fairly consistent, and therefore there is some level of protection.
I mean, I would contend, Mr McDonald, that as a government we've always been fair to local government. We know that spending by councils on education is set to increase by 3.3%. We know that in terms of total revenue spend on schools since 2006-07, that has went up by at least £208 million. But I'll go back to one of my original points, Convener. Yes, we're all living in financial difficult times. Nonetheless, attainment is improving and we're closing the gap.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Government's response to the committee's draft budget report states that there's a large number of government initiatives underway to close the attainment gap or to improve the attainment overall. Now, the response actually describes 13 separate initiatives, some of which are on a universal basis, some of which are on an area basis, and that's on top of any local initiatives. Some participants have, in the informal discussion we had, seemed to indicate that there was perhaps a difficulty in having a joined-up policy with so many diverse elements. Given the wide range of attainment initiatives and their geographical coverage, how are we evaluating success and achievement in terms of the attainment gap?
Yeah. I mean, it is imperative that everything hangs together strategically and that we're ensuring that all the arrows are flying in the direction. I mean, the overarching vision and the overarching approach is set out through the National Improvement Framework for Scotland. That's the vision of both equity and excellence. And, you know, the framework sets out the six proven drivers for improvement in terms of assessing pupils' progress, you know, parental engagement involvement, leadership, professional standards, you know, school improvement. And all of that, you know, has to fit in with the objectives of Curriculum for Excellence. And I suppose underlying, you know, the National Improvement Framework, we've got the National Improvement Hub and Attainment Advisors, you know, which is about working very specifically with local authorities, but also ensuring that we're sharing the research that's available and that the research has indeed been able to be implemented in practice. And yes, you know, thereafter we have, you know, the targeted work through the attainment challenge. As I said, it's imperative that the learning and the evaluation from the attainment challenge, that actually benefits all schools. And of course, the role of the Improvement Hub and Attainment Advisors are important. In terms of, I suppose, things like the Raising Attainment for All programme, the Early Years Collaborative, the Schools Improvement programme, it is crucial that the case studies, the exemplars of good practice, that they are collected and evaluated and are actually used to contribute to systems-wide improvement. So I am, you know, quite confident that, you know, that it all hangs together sensibly, logically, and strategically. Evaluation is a very important part of the attainment challenge. Raising Attainment for All programme, for example, is subject to, you know, continuous evaluation. That's the whole thing about improvement methodology and the Plan, Do, Study Act. So it is integral, you know, part of our approach to education. And of course, Scotland is a world leader in self-evaluation.
In terms of the evaluation, presumably part of that would be to identify successful or effective interventions. Is there going to be a process whereby that good example can then be rolled out across the country?
Yeah, and I mean, for example, in terms of the attainment challenge, there is a four-year evaluation strategy. It also has academic input into that from the Robert Owen Centre in terms of, you know, Professor Chapman. So while the, you know, attainment challenge is very focused on the local authorities and schools, you know, and the highest areas of deprivation, there will be very important learning and practices that will indeed have to be, you know, rolled out across the country.
As part of the evaluation process, are existing policies being evaluated to ensure that they're contributing towards raising attainment? And I'm thinking of the pupil-teacher ratio, class sizes and so on.
Well, I mean, I think part of our duties and responsibilities in terms of the annual reporting that we will have to do in terms of meeting our inequalities of outcomes duties and the annual reporting to show that we're meeting the strategic objectives of the National Improvement Framework, I think, is very much about that. We don't want, you know, annual reporting, whether it's from local or national government, that simply lists what you do. It has to be evaluating impact and outcome. And where, you know, impact and outcome is unknown, we have to find, you know, the means of establishing that.
Thank you. I'm curious, Cabinet Secretary, about one thing. We're going to measure, obviously, very closely those programmes that you've mentioned in great detail. And I'm just wondering, if you find a programme that is effective at raising attainment but not effective at closing the attainment gap, what would happen to that programme? Would that programme be discontinued, or would you roll that out, or what?
I mean, we've always been clear that, you know, we're not going to close the attainment gap by holding down standards, actually, because that would be the wrong thing to do. Our curriculum and curriculum for excellence is about children as individuals. But we do need to focus on areas of improvement where we need to improve faster. We have a twin-track approach, if you like. I mean, I think there will be very few there may well be some bespoke examples, but I think there will be very few initiatives that will, you know, do one thing in isolation. And obviously our focus in terms of targeting resources and additional initiatives is to address the equity gap where we want to make faster progress. But I don't see us, you know, throwing out good examples or initiatives that raise attainment but don't specifically address the equity gap. We should, of course, you know, be looking. You know, if something, you know, was making a problem worse, you know, we clearly wouldn't want to be doing that.
No, it's a hypothetical question. Yeah. I was curious, So I thought I'd ask. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I thank you and your officials for coming along this morning? There are other areas where we just don't have time to get into, not necessarily with the attainment stuff, but also with the Funding Council and student support that... I think what we'll do is we'll write to you, if you don't mind, about that. And obviously we would appreciate, given the time scale between now and dissolution, we would very much appreciate it if you could respond before dissolution.
Absolutely, I'll give you that guarantee.
Thank you very much. With that, I close the meeting.